Hello everyone, so this is Mansi from Java Techies. Today I again got 10 top questions asked in multiple interviews into different organizations along with their answers. I'm here to explain you. These are basically related to core Java only. So let's move ahead one by one. So the first one is how to make an object immutable in Java. And why should you make an object immutable? So if you know about the concept of immutable, so I'll just explain you with an example. Like for example, we all know string is immutable in Java. So when we declare it, like for example, string str is equal to into double quotes, suppose abc. So what it does is its memory actually gets allocated into the string pool. It first checks if there is some ABC, the value that you have actually assigned to it is actually present into the string pool already or not. If that is present, your reference S is going to point to that particular memory location. If that is not present, it is going to create ABC and then refer to that particular memory location. So in this case, you can see if you have, like, suppose for example, string str is equal to abc, str1 is equal to abc, so multiple references are actually pointing to the same memory location in the string pool. This means that if suppose this is not immutable, you are able to modify the string, in that case actually your actual value will be overridden, which means that since multiple references are pointing to it, all the values of all the references will be actually updated, which will introduce inconsistency problems. So in order to solve these kind of issues, we have string as immutable, so that the multiple references that are pointing to the same memory location do not get modified. That is why we restrict that particular memory location changes. Now the next question is how to make an object immutable in Java. So in order to make an object immutable in Java, first of all you have to declare the class as final. So that should be final class, so that none of the child class can actually be able to inherit that. So as we all know that final classes cannot be inherited. The second thing is we want all our data members that are there in the class to be private, so that no other class or no other client application can actually modify the values of the data members of that particular class. Apart from this, we also have data members in the class to be declared as final. Again, so that first of all private, so that they cannot be accessed from outside, and final, so that their values can actually not be modified. Apart from that, in the parameterized constructor, we will have to perform a deep copy and then assign the values, so that the data members cannot be modified with the object reference. So if you do a shallow copy or things like that, so your object reference will actually get modified. But in case of deep copy, you create a new object and then assign the values. So deep copy should be performed and there should be no setters that should be provided, so that again some other client application can't actually modify your values. Apart from that, you should also perform deep copy of objects in the getter method, so that you do not return the actual object reference. In case you return the object or actual object reference, the client will or some other calling party will be able to actually modify it. Now moving on to the next question, which two methods of hash map key object should implement? So as we all know, like in the internal implementation of hash map, we have, as soon as we do a hash map dot put, we calculate the hash code and then we do a mod by the capacity, and then we are able to find out, okay, this is a bucket onto which we have to create a particular node. So hashcode is a method that is there into object class, which we should override based on our implementation. If suppose you have like your own employee object, your customized object, so in that case you can modify the hash code based on your requirement as well. If you do not do that, every time they will call the hash code method of the object class itself. The second one is equals method. So if in case suppose you have your hash code and you get your bucket, then what happens is, as we all know, keys are unique into HashMap. So every time it will actually check if there is some other key that is equal to the current key that I am trying to put into the HashMap. If that is equal, it uses actually equals method to check that. If that is equal, it actually replaces the previous one. If it is not equal, it actually creates a new node. So at times in interviews they ask questions like, suppose I have overridden the hash code method and I am continuously returning 100 in its implementation, for example. So what will be the behavior? So suppose every time you are returning the same value as part of hash code, then every time the hash code mod capacity will actually be the same, and nodes will be created on the same bucket. So that will hamper the performance of HashMap. So every time we have some customized kind of object, we have to override the hashcode method properly so that our HashMap behaves in an efficient way. Another question that is asked is if suppose I do not override the equals method. So if you do not override the equals method, again it will use the equals method that is there into object class, and we all know that the equals method that is there into object class actually compares the value along with the reference as well. So if you do not, suppose I have again a customized object, for example employee, I haven't overridden this equals method. So what it will do is, every time it will use the object class equals method, which compares the content along with the reference as well. Suppose I have done a new employee two times and I am actually having the same employee ID, same employee name, but still it will use the equals method of object class, so it will also compare the reference, which will be different. So those two employees having similar values but different references will be considered as unequal, and they will be present in the HashMap. So these are the implications of not properly overriding the hashcode and equals methods. Moving ahead to the next question. So what is the difference between string, string buffer and string builder in Java? So if you talk about string, string is immutable in nature, as we all know. String buffer and string builder are mutable. That means you can modify the values of string buffer and string builder. However, you cannot modify the value of string. Now if you talk about storage, so if you do like a string str is equal to abc, or you provide any kind of literal to that, so that will be actually stored in the string pool. However, string builder and string buffer, we use new operator with that, so these get stored into the heap memory. However, if you do string str is equal to new string using the string constructor, that will also occupy the heap memory as well. Now moving ahead to thread safety. So string is thread safe in nature, however, and string buffer is also thread safe. However, string builder is not thread safe in nature, which means that the performance of string builder will be lower as compared to the rest of the two. So if you talk about thread safety, you will have to compromise on the performance as well. But in case of multi-threaded environment, we should go for string buffer based on our requirement. However, if you do not have any multi-threaded environment, then string builder will be better in performance. Now moving ahead to the next question, what is the difference between ArrayList and linked list in Java? So as we know, ArrayList is a form of array in Java, whereas linked list consists of collection of nodes similar to linked list data structure. So ArrayList actually provide random access using the index, whereas linked list allows sequential searching of elements. So now the question occurs, which is preferred in which scenario? So if suppose you have more amount of get operations on your data structure, so in that case the performance of ArrayList is way better than linked list, because it provides you random access. You can simply provide the index and it will give you the value. And if you talk about insertion and deletions, if you have to perform more of insertions in the middle of the list, or maybe delete an element from the middle of the list, in that case linked list is better, because you just have to modify the references of the previous and next node, However, in case of array list, if you delete or update some element in the middle of the list, then all the elements to the right of it has to be shifted. So in that case, performance of linked list is better than array list. Moving ahead to the next question. So the next one is how to check if the linked list contains a loop in Java. So this is also a very commonly asked question. People also ask for code related to this. I will just update the code of this in the comment section. So I will just explain you the logic over here. So in order to check if a linked list contains a loop, we usually use two pointers starting from the first node. Now the first pointer will actually move two nodes ahead at a particular time, and the second pointer will actually move one by one. So since the first one is moving two nodes ahead, that means it is moving fast. So at any point, if suppose the first pointer points to the second one, that means there is a loop. If it doesn't and the first one reaches to null, node dot next is null, that means there is no loop. It has already traversed the entire linked list. Now moving on to the next one. So what is the difference between abstract class and interface? So before, if we talk about before Java 8, abstract class used to consist of concrete and abstract methods, whereas interface used to consist of all the abstract methods. You have to provide different implementations using the implement keyword in case of interface. However, in case of abstract class, you had to extend it and provide the implementations of all the abstract methods. So if you talk about differences after Java 8, so the differences amongst the two has been minimized, and right now we just have the major differences with interface. You can have multiple, you can actually implement multiple interfaces into a particular class. However, if you talk about abstract class, still extending multiple classes is not allowed. So multiple inheritance is not allowed still in Java. So that is one of the major difference if you talk about differences between abstract class and interface after Java 8. Now moving on to the next one. So the next one is, can we have a return statement in the finally clause? What will happen? Yes, definitely we can have a return statement in the finally clause. Now suppose I have a try block and I have a finally, or a catch block as well. I'm returning a statement. Suppose I'm doing a return 5 into my try and I have return 8 into my finally block. So what will happen is the output of this will be 8. Actually, it will return 8. So whatever is returned into try block will actually be overridden by the finally block. Now moving on to the next one, can you override the static method in Java? The answer is no. We cannot override static methods because these are actually resolved at compile time and not at runtime. If you know, overriding is dynamic polymorphism, that is, it is done at runtime. However, if you talk about static, static actually deals with compile time things. So in case if you have a static method in your parent class and you have a similar kind of with similar signature, you have a static method in your child class, that will automatically hide definitely the parent one, but that is data hiding, not specifically referred as overriding, because again static just deals with compile time, not runtime, so that is referred to as data hiding. Moving on to the next one, what is the difference between calling start and run method in a thread? So as we all know, we call thread.start, it actually internally calls the run method and generates a new thread. And calls the run method. Whereas if you call, suppose you do a thread.run directly, so that will behave like a normal object calling run method. It is not going to create any of the new thread. Now the next one is, what will happen if you put return statement or system.exit on try or catch block? Will finally block be executed? Definitely, finally block will always be executed. no matter whatever you have into your try and catch. However, if you have system.exit somewhere into your try or catch block, at that point of time your program is going to terminate. Only in that particular case your finally block will not be executed. So that's it from my end. I have hope I have given all the answers for these questions in a better manner. I hope you like the video. So keep watching us, keep supporting us. Do like, share, comment, and in case you have some questions, please do write in the comment section. I will be happy to help you out. Thank you. Thank you so much. Bye bye.